Hurricane Ian is moving across Florida tonight after making landfall as a Category 4 this afternoon on the Gulf Coast. The storm is one of the most powerful ever recorded in the U.S., bringing 150 mile an hour plus winds. Nearly 2 million are without power. Streets and buildings are flooded, including this fire station in Naples. Sheriff's departments are reporting calls from people trapped in their flooded homes. Florida Governor Ron DeSantis says this storm will leave a big impact on the state.
This is a really, really significant storm. It will be one of the storms people always remember.
President Joe Biden is promising to send help to Florida as they clean up and rebuild from the storm. Chief Meteorologist George Lessons has been keeping us up to date throughout the day on Hurricane Ian. He's now with the latest information. It's starting to lose some of its power.
Down to a Category 1 now, Juliet, as it's moving over central Florida. Here are the latest stats on that. It has been downgraded to a Category 1. It made landfall southwest of Punta Gorda at about 3:05 this afternoon as a Category 4. Tornado watch for the eastern part of the state, but you can see all the bands of rain up through the Daytona Beach area heading toward Jacksonville. And tornado watch, and there are the stats, 70 miles southwest of Orlando, Florida, with gusts to 115 miles per hour. And at one point, they were measured 140 mile per hour winds at Cape Coral. There are still a number of hurricane warnings, hurricane watches, and tropical storm warnings. And still, we're looking perhaps up to 18-foot storm surge, especially down around the Fort Myers area, even though the storm has come on shore. Flood warnings, flash flood warning across central Florida. Of course, a lot of rain, up to 30 inches of rain is possible. It will exit the east coast of Florida around 8 o'clock in the morning on Thursday, remain a tropical storm, and actually come back on shore Friday morning as a tropical storm into South Carolina before it heads on up into the Carolinas. What we might see from that will be just some high clouds and a little bit of wind during the day on Sunday. Here are some of the wind gusts up around 60 to 70 miles per hour, and they're still gusting to 60 there at St. Petersburg, Florida. The storm at one point was up to 155 miles per hour. Did some research on the strongest hurricanes, not even in the top 25. Here are some of the strongest storms, including Dorian back in 2019 that had 185 mile per hour winds at landfall. And in terms of pressure, another way that we measure that, you can see 937 millibars, not even in the top 25, is one of the strongest hurricanes here in West Michigan. This is a very rare hurricane. Charlie was the last one to come up through there. Donna, a few years earlier, back 1960. Only 10 storms have come within 50 miles of Fort Myers since 1870. So this is a very rare event. In West Michigan, much calmer, but we've got a chance of frost. We'll talk about that in a minute.
There are West Michigan natives now living on Florida's Gulf Coast where the hurricane made landfall this afternoon. Some evacuated, others decided to stay. 13 On Your Side's Trevier Gonzalez talked to a family from Big Rapids who watched as Hurricane Ian moved in.
Yeah, Juliet, that's right. Even though we are states away from Florida, whether it's through friends or families, we're seeing all the different ways the impact there are affecting us here. And when it comes to Ian's power, one family I connected with ended up standing their ground through it all.
A snapshot of destruction, giving just a glimpse to the challenges happening in Florida.
Now we're right up next to the eye where we're at.
This video from Larry Cox of Big Rapids, who now lives in Charlotte County. The part-time Michigander digging in with family and a neighbor at their home. His granddaughter's fiance from West Michigan says they had a mandatory evacuation, but with gas stations being out of fuel and outgoing traffic jamming the highways, they are riding the storm out.
It's kind of indescribable, but it's very, very strong winds, probably 150 mile an hour with 180 mile an hour gusts. A lot of flooding and constant debris coming down the road in the backyard.
But others have chosen to leave. Captain Bill Smith with Grand Rapids Fire started his career in Tarpon Springs, but many of his families are still in West Florida. He tells us that he spoke with his sister.
She knows that the power is out at her home in Port Charlotte, but she doesn't know the extent of the damage in the area as of yet, so they're just kind of waiting it out.
With no eyes on the ground just yet at their Port Charlotte home, Captain Smith says his sister is holding on to rumors that their house isn't flooded.
Hopefully she won't have any flooding to contend with for her home, but we don't know about wind damage yet.
Captain Smith says the Grand Rapids Fire Department has 6 members who are a part of the Michigan Task Force 1 who would be able to provide aid to the state of Florida at a moment's notice. He believes that would require a request from FEMA, and per our last conversation, that request has not yet happened. Juliet.
Thank you, Tevier. The devastation brought by Hurricane Ian is obvious from the ground, but Cheetah Craft, the meteorologist with our sister station in Houston, was invited to fly with the hurricane hunters today. He was on board when Ian made landfall.
At 10:30 this morning, we boarded this WC-130J. The 53rd Weather Reconnaissance Squadron and the U.S. Naval Academy on the same flight, 2 separate missions.
This is an airborne expendable BAPI thermograft. It's used by a group from the U.S. Naval Academy that then pushes that into a launcher. Through this launcher, it can go down as low as 800 meters into the ocean. It has a radio inside that then signals back the water temperature inside a plane.
2 different instruments on this flight that help gather data for tropical systems.
The drop sons, they get a profile of the atmosphere from where we drop them on the plane down to the surface of the ocean.
Christina Peretta is an in-flight meteorologist who's in constant coordination with the National Hurricane Center.
There's actually a few messages from them right now. We have a SATCOM system that we can message back and forth with them. And we're really looking at those surface winds, because when the National Hurricane Center puts out their warnings and advisories, that's what the strength of the storm is based on, is the wind surface.
When hurricane hunters fly in these storms, the information they collect is invaluable. The track from the hurricane center can change, which means evacuations change, which saves lives.
I think that's probably one of the most rewarding parts of the job, is that we know that we're out here doing something that's going to make an impact on potentially millions of people.
The American Red Cross already has hundreds of volunteers in Florida, including people from Michigan. They started deploying from all across the country, including West Michigan, last week in anticipation of the storm. The volunteers are helping local and state leaders at evacuation shelters. There are more than 13,000 people in those shelters across Florida right now. And now that the storm has made landfall, they plan on sending many more volunteers to shelters that are going to be open for a while.
Emergency shelters include health services, mental health services, feeding services. Those are more for the long term, where people have major damage to their homes. They can't go back home and they don't have any other place to go. We are there for them.
The Red Cross says right now the biggest needs are financial and blood donations.